Yeah, it's green.
Can I start now, or you announce me? Or? Ah, okay. Hey, my name is Andrew Minkin, and today I'm going to tell you at least two stories from my work experience. And my talk is on geospatial dev room, so I should speak more about geodata and less about Go. So who am I? How can I be useful for you? I've been working for MedDevs.io for the last 5 years, and now I'm team lead there. And I try to contribute to open source projects as much as I can, and one of my favorite projects is MeshBird. With MeshBird you can build virtual private networks between your data centers, virtual machines, or Docker containers. So I'm from Bishkek, it's the capital of Kyrgyzstan, and it's a small city with population around 1 million people, and for that 1 million people we have around 100 taxi services. One of our clients is Namba Taxi, is a leader on the market, and it processes more than 6,000 orders and has more than 600 online drivers and around 500,000 of clients. And 500,000 of clients is actually half of our city. So what's a taxi? First of all, it's our clients, client books taxi via SMS, voice, or IPTV, or mobile application. And the order is processed by an operator, and once it becomes available to drivers, driver can take it from mobile application. Client sees the taxi and goes to the destination point, and at the end the order is finished, and the client can see a report on the mobile application or on the website, and also the managers can do the same. And the average response, these workflows are automated by our backend systems, and the average response time for drivers is 20 milliseconds and for operators 2.5 milliseconds. So first study is about simple in-memory data storage for geodata, and it starts from graduation work of our mobile developer. in the work topic was driver application for taxi service, and in the application he has animated the car, and it looked like this, but the animations don't work. So we thought, why not using this on the screen where the client can track a driver location? And first challenge that we faced was a lack of data. For instance, we get a new location from driver in 15 seconds, and we can't just decrease update interval because when driver's mobile application sends data to us, it gets status of current order, next order, and is there any alerts. And our first try was simple and simple. We tried to make a request, then we save coordinates, make another request, and then try animate the car. As you can guess, there were problems with it. We can't animate car properly, and it moves through fields, forests, quarters, and it looked like this, but it doesn't work. As a solution of the problem, we used OpenStreetMap routing machine for building roads, and our algorithm improved, and we have same time mount, we make requests, send coordinates, send coordinates to our backend, build road via SRM, and return to the client app and animate the car. But we face with another problem with one-way roads. For instance, driver stays at the red point of, on the crossroad, but his device has bad accuracy on location of date. He stays on the side of the crossroad. Get these coordinates, send it to OSRM, and it builds a legit road, return to the app, and it looks ridiculous because marker moves so fast. And as a solution of the problem, we just check distance between two points and not building road for a distance less than 20 meters. After several days of testing, we decided to release our applications and go to the next iteration because several things need improvements. First is the trip cost calculations were on the driver's side. At this point, we have we save several resources because we don't send useless requests. But and the second point, we have only one trust point. It's a driver mobile application. And also we realized that send one track per 15 seconds is too less, and lots of customers don't get sight of our feature because I know not so many people who can look at the screen where there's nothing going on for 15 seconds. And also we has lots of problems with GPS module on the driver's side, and as for them, first two are associated with the device, and in our country we use brand new cheap Chinese device for a taxi service, and so we need to handle this too. And here is a task that we need to solve, and I want to say some words about saving mobile data, why we need it, because in our country we have a cheap receipt for a taxi service, and internet cost is too high. For instance, you can get from one side of the city to another side of the city just for 2 euros. It's like a bus in Brussels or metro in Paris. And if we save at least 100 bytes per second, then we save around $2,000 at company scale. So what's the track? Track is composed from the driver location, session, and trip information. I mean the order ID and trip cost. And we decided that we need to that one track should be less than 100 bytes. And we started to search transport protocol for it, and we watched for the several protocols, and for us ideal option was UDP because of these facts. And I know that in some countries for mobile networks UDP can be blocked, but for our case it was okay, so we chose UDP. And for data serialization, we chose protocol buffers because it's so efficient on little data, and as you can see, the nearest competitor is heavier twice. So totally, what do we have? We have 40 bytes of payload plus 20 bytes of IP headers. That equals 62 bytes per track, and we solve the problem. And when we get data, we need also to store it. And the second part of the story is data storage, and we need to store driver session that we give upon login, and to identify driver, cab number to perform search of driver for client's mobile application, order ID and trip calls to save trip information on the server side. Last locations to perform search of nearest drivers, and then last locations to build a road. So in Namba Taxi, we use Percona server to store all the data. We store drivers, fares, and everything in Percona. We use Redis server for caching purposes and Elasticsearch for geocoding. And in the second part of the story, I tell you more about how we use it. As I mentioned above, we have more than 600 online drivers, and use these storages to store data seems no accident, and we decided to build our own memory storage. And first of all, we need a geoindex to store data, and we watched for two geoindices, KD3 and R3. And we had requirements for geoindex, and first we need to search any rest points, and it must be balanced tree. We watched on the KD3, it looks like this, but it doesn't fit our needs because it's unbalanced tree, and it can search only one nearest point. Yes, we can implement k nearest point over KD3, but we won't reinvent the wheel because R3 already has it. So for our storage, we chose R3, and for Go programming language, you can get it there. So going next, we live in not ideal world, and drivers can just turn off your phone, and you need to invalidate some data, and driver's workflow can be ideal for us. They have better internet connectivity, or the reasons that you can see on the slide. And to solve the problem, we need an expire mechanism to invalidate drivers and show only actual information to our operators, and also we need LRU data structure for storing coordinates, because it's useful. You only initialize the data structure for n items, and when you try to add a new item when storage is already filled, you remove least recently used item and add a new one. So here is the final storage architecture that we use. We store all data in memory. We're using R3 to perform search of nearest drivers, and also we use two maps for storing drivers and perform search by cab number or by session. So here is the algorithm on backend. We try to get data by UDP. We try to get driver from the storage. If it doesn't exist, we get some driver information from Redis. We check and validate data. We try to set driver to storage. If it doesn't exist, we initialize LRU. And finally, we update R3. And we use Go programming language to implement this because of these facts. And when we discovered Go, we fell in love with it and refactored it all. Our microservices written on Python and Ruby to the Go programming language. And also we need HTTP IP to integrate it to our service. And we implemented these endpoints. And at that point, we were ready to deploy it. And I want to tell you, but before, we need to know how to maintain it, and I want to tell you more about user/status and bots, because first three items are obvious. So user/status returns uptime since server has started, HTTP status counters, and total requests processed by the server. And we use bots to emulate our workflow for drivers and clients, and they are running near Morocco or Congo to prevent influence on our customers. So for a client mobile applications, looks like this. We get client location from the server sensors. We get nearest drivers with rows, we animate each car, and the update interval is 15 seconds for the client application. So that's the main slide of the first story, and the second story is about challenges with geocoding in developing countries. So Bishkek is a city with small quarters, and people book taxi to intersections very often. Also we have lack of data from Google, OpenStreetMap, and whatever provider we have. And also we can't trust GPS data from our drivers because, as I said above, we have bad devices. So we use OpenStreetMap data for our purposes because it's more detailed in our country, and also we have own database with addresses that collected from our drivers. So we need to find a way how to merge OpenStreetMap data with our own database, and we decided to build our own geocoder. And in our geocoder we need to support these search formats. For instance, user can build query by street plus house number, intersection, name of institution, point of interest, micro district plus house number, or micro district plus street plus house number. And also we need to support different we need to support synonyms because we use shortest version of names, and we chose Elasticsearch because of ease of use, and we created addresses slice to combine two geoindices with a similar scheme, and we use OpenStreetMap data and drivers data, and drivers data populates from our drivers and improves search quality. So you only need to run slash Ariadna update, and you may go and drink coffee, and when you drink coffee, Ariadna does this stuff. So here is a short list of features, and you can get it there. So thank you for your patience. If you have any questions, that's all. Yes.
The final application is already being used now, isn't it?
Yes.
The first statistics you gave were about usage of this application or the general use of the taxis? Or my question is actually, how many people are using it right now?
You mean the clients or drivers? For the clients, it's around 6,000 people as a per day, and for drivers it's around more than 600 online drivers. So yes.
You mentioned you used Elasticsearch for the geo search. Did you consider to use Redis for that?
No, we watched for Elasticsearch a year ago. And I know that Redis now have some geo features, but when we tried to build our geocoder, we weren't know about Redis. I mean that about the geo features. So.
Any more questions?
Yes. For TCP, you need to do a handshake, so you need to send SYN, then ACK, and then SYN ACK, and it's 60 bytes. only for only for connection. And UDP, you send only datagrams, and you you save at least 60 bytes because you don't need to. Yes. Yes.
You mentioned that you used OpenStreetMap data for showing the map. You have your own database of addresses to merge them. Is it merged every time, or did you merge the addresses into the OpenStreetMap database?
So we use only we for from the OpenStreetMap use only data, and we update our index at once a day.
Yeah, so you don't provide back the, you don't deliver input to OpenStreetMap to make the map better for everyone using it.
Because we yes, now we have plans to do it, but now we weren't sure that our data will be helpful because of addresses formats, and that's all.
Okay,
thank you.
Yeah, that's right. Oh, no, I know.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.